Well, welcome everyone. It's 2 o'clock here in Nashville, Tennessee. So we'll go ahead and get started. Welcome to Starting Early, Introducing Career Development in the Early Grades. I'm Nicole Cobb, your Vice President of Counseling and Career Development for ACTE. And we're very excited to be hosting this exciting webinar for you all today. And with me, I have an expert panel that I know you're gonna enjoy getting to know. Next slide, Brandy. I guess before the panel, I wanna do special thanks to our sponsor, Zello. They've partnered with ACT on a student career development series. And over the coming months, you're going to see several publications that I know you'll want to check out and share with your colleagues. The first one was actually released this past fall, Starting Early, and it's what our webinar today is based on. And then to come, Delivering Real World Experiences, Unifying Your District in This Work, Connecting Social Emotional Learning to Career Success, and then Using Technology to Deliver Equity. So there'll be webinars tied to each of these along with papers and journal articles. So we hope you'll stay tuned for more to come. Next slide. So with me today, I have a panel that was highlighted in our publication and is here to share more details and best practices with each of you. Brian, can I start with you?
Sure. Hello, my name is Brian Bontempo. I'm the superintendent of the Auburn Career Center. We serve 10 school districts in Lake and Geauga counties, which are on the east side of Cleveland. And we also operate in Ohio Technical College, which services non-degree students in our region as well. Really glad to be here. Thank you.
Thanks, Brian. And Caroline?
Hi, I am Caroline Cockman, and I'm an elementary school counselor in Apex, North Carolina, at Apex Elementary, and that's outside of Raleigh, North Carolina. We're part of the Wake County Public School System, which is the largest school system in North Carolina, and we're currently learning virtually. Prior to becoming a school counselor in 06, I was a classroom teacher, a third grade teacher as well. And I serve students in kindergarten through fifth grade as the only counselor, and we have 650 students.
What a big job, Caroline. That's a lot of caseload. And Dana.
Yes, hello everybody. I'm Dana Jackson. I'm the Executive Director of Counseling Services and College Access with Grand Prairie Independent School District in Grand Prairie, Texas. Our district is situated between Dallas and Fort Worth. We have about 30,000 students. We are a district of innovation and choice with programs from STEM academies to pathway programs to single gendered schools. And so in my role, I supervise counselors, social workers, college access advisors, and I work very, very closely with our CTE executive director and our CTE programs. And just that connection has been very powerful for our district. We make sure that we're helping students, not just academically, but social, emotionally, and with college and career as well.
So important that we're delivering holistic education and all those wraparound services. So thank you, Dana. And to our participants, I love seeing you typing in the chat, telling us who you are and where you're from. Please keep that up. And also, I'll keep an eye on the chat. If you have questions, pop them in there and I'll do my best to work them in. And then maybe we'll have time at the end to open it up for more questions and answers, but please feel free to engage in the chat. And if you have resources that support what you're hearing, we would welcome you sharing those with the group as well. So welcome everyone and thank you, panel. So Caroline, as an elementary school teacher and now counselor, you have a unique perspective that's important and different from those of us that work at the middle or high school level. Could you tell us a little bit more about that and how you do career exploration and awareness with the littles?
Sure, yes. So at the elementary age, as I mentioned, I work with students from kindergarten to fifth grade. So that in itself is quite a developmental stage from what we know about child development. So we sort of, they sort of are starting out that early stage kind of with fantasizing, imagination, play about, you know, their future. As they sort of get in the middle grades to upper elementary, they'll start gaining interest and noticing what they're interested in, what their preferences are, and noticing that that can change over time. And then also starting to build capacity for skills. So our main thing in elementary school is really just help getting kids to envision their future self and what that might look like. So much like the social emotional learning we do with career exploration, there's kind of four approaches we take in our elementary school. And so the first is when we're thinking about career exploration, we are integrating that into just general teaching practices or as part of the broader curriculum. So an example of that might be, I know our fifth graders recently were doing a rainforest study in science, for example, and a lot of kind of, there was a lot of opportunity to talk about careers such as the cattle farmers in Belize and the botanists that are doing research and that kind of thing. So kind of integrating it into what's already happening in the broader curriculum. And you can go to the next slide, Randy. Also, I think of our first graders, and here's some pictures from some of their studies, but they learn in social studies, what is a community, that we all have to contribute to our community, and then who are the community helpers. So that obviously lends itself well for a lot of career exploration and starting to expose students to the types of careers that are even available to make a community work. This is a picture of a first grader who learned about being a prenatal nurse. And the next slide, Brandy, please. Another sort of approach is just general teaching practices that incorporate career skills and social emotional skills. So when you walk into an elementary classroom, and most kids are self-contained in our district, so they have a kindergarten teacher, and of course they collaborate with teams. Those are things like teaching children how to collaborate in a group, what it looks like to work in a group, what it looks like to set a goal for an assignment, what it looks like to participate in a class discussion. So just kind of these skills that are sort of general teaching practices, but we know will help kids become career ready in the future. And you can look at the next slide, just a few examples. These are just things snapshotted from a classroom. What are the collaborative norms in this classroom? What are some sentence stems when you agree or disagree with an idea? So developing those types of skills. Next slide. And as you can see, those first two especially rely heavily on that classroom teacher. And so a lot of the work I do with career exploration is in conjunction with classroom teachers and helping them find those pockets of opportunity. And then another approach is freestanding career instruction and exploration. And that's something that teachers can do alone, but also I do in freestanding lessons. For example, our fifth and fourth graders do a specific unit of study on taking an interest survey and matching interests to career clusters and learning that just, you know, you might want to be a certain something when you grow up, but there's also things that are related to that. So explicitly teaching how to set a goal and monitor that and reach it as well. Next slide, please. One of those that I mentioned, the fourth and fifth grade career exploration, sort of culminates in a career day where the Cougars at our school, where small groups, students get to self-select a variety of presenters to learn about their careers in sort of hands-on, developmentally appropriate ways. So that's just one example of sort of that isolated, explicit teaching of a career. And then finally is the school-wide opportunity to foster and learn career skills and then value future planning. And that could look like participating in a choral performance, being part of a group, working backstage, getting the makeup ready, that kind of thing. As the school counselor, I run what we call Cougar Core, which is just a job kind of core program for our fifth graders where they actually get to apply for a job. They are hired or not, they are trained, and those jobs might be helping in a kindergarten or first grade classroom, in the media center, doing safety patrol, and they receive feedback on their job performance and then can kind of reapply if openings become available. So one, it really helps us around the school because we're, you know, schools that we always need extra hands, but also it really gives them the sense of purpose of I can contribute to this. This is fun. I like this job. I do not like this job. Those types of things. So they can just start to understand that what they're doing now can relate to the world of work a little bit later on. So these are kind of the four main approaches when I think about career at the elementary level. Let's go to the next slide, Brandy.
All right, thank you. Were you finished, Caroline? Was that the last slide? Great, thank you so much. This makes me want to go back to school in your district, your school. Brian, I know that I've really enjoyed learning about what you're doing with the Auburn Career Centers and how it relates to the early grades. Could you tell all of us a little more about that work?
Sure. So it's been really the last year and a half, we've spent a lot of time planning and working on this. And what we realized is that even though we're a career center, we serve primarily 11th and 12th graders and some 10th graders. It's really part of our responsibility to help in the career development, and our outreach program to the middle schools really has expanded. We all know that the more informed students and families are as they go through their academic career and their grades, the better informed they are, the better decisions they make. And at the end of the day, it maximizes all of our resources. So we really invested in that process. And so we really wanted to really change that culture in our middle schools. And we have a person that's in their full-time assignment is that middle school outreach coordinator. And we have 10 school districts. And but what we really needed was a point person in each of our local middle schools that was our outreach person. So typically we're used to having conversations with high school people all the time. And so middle school people, you know, often we don't know what goes on there. And so we're not gonna chase down the information. So we knew we had to reach out to them. And so we put a very simple agreement together with each of our school districts and said, we're gonna do some things for you, but in turn, we'd like you to identify a point person in your building. Most of them are guidance counselors, school counselors, there's some administrators, but so we had a point person. So when we picked up the phone and called them and say, hey, we have this really neat thing we'd like to share, there's somebody on their end that has a responsibility. And then as a result, also somebody at the central office who is a point person. So there's a communication system in place. Our side of that obligation is that we're going to start to show up in their school and do some pretty neat things. And so that's really where my staff did a great job creating some really innovative ideas. And so what we really wanted to do is not take time away from what school districts were doing every day in their middle schools, but find where there were connections between what career and technical education is all about and what's going on in the middle school classrooms. And so where were they teaching certain concepts that just made sense for us to insert those career technical education opportunities? So we did some research, we had some conversations, and many of you are probably familiar with Snap-on Tools. Well, Snap-on Tools has this micro-credential platform, and there's a long list. You can go on their website and look, and we called them and talked to them, and we broke down their curriculum, and long story short is, we found some pretty neat opportunities where we can actually take concepts from that Snap-on Tool has, match it up with curriculum in the middle school, and we can use as an introduction so we can teach concepts. And then we actually have some of our own students also on those calls, or right now they're calls or they're Zoom calls, and say, hey, this is how it comes to life and what I'm doing at school. So I'll give you a couple of examples. The first one that we started with is tape and rule. So it's a measurement lesson. It's about 8 hours. Snap-on Tool and NC3 is our partner. So the students, when they complete, they get a credential certification and it says they've completed tape and rule. We found that seventh grade was a great spot for it. So we worked with seventh grade math teachers. And our person on our end, Kaylee Volpin's her name, she went and worked with the teacher and we integrated that curriculum in the seventh grade. And when they were finished, they receive a Snap-on Tool Auburn Career Center credential. And what's happened in the last month, is the state of Ohio now recognizes that as it's earning points towards, in Ohio, you have to have 12 points as a credential option. And so they're actually earning points towards that accumulation of 12 points. We're waiting for the details on it. So then to add to that, we're looking at torque, which is in the sciences somewhere, perhaps. Multimeter, which is, electronics and so on. So each one of those areas spans multiple programs when they actually get to the high school age. And then these students, and then our plan is to continue to do that in other grades. We also have CPR and some other first aid and things of that nature that we're developing. But what's happened is it's opened the eyes of our partner districts. So when we have a conversation with curriculum directors in one of our neighboring or partner districts, they now are starting to understand the dialogue. They start asking questions. Well, what about this? And what about, is there funding for that? And so now it's opened the doors to that conversation. So what's really also just as important, we're building a strong partnership with our districts as opposed to a place where they send students when they're in 11th grade. So far, knock on wood, it's been very well received, and we're looking forward to continuing to build it.
Great, thank you, Brian. So as I'm listening to Brian and Caroline talk, Dana, I'm thinking about, it takes a village. You can't do this work just at one school in an isolation. So thinking about your role at the district level, how do you collaborate and bring in all the different entities, CTE teachers, school counselors, other teachers, to make this come together for students?
I think it's just very important, like you said, at the district level, that everyone's working together for a common goal. When we work in silos, we miss the opportunity to really integrate, because a lot of the, as the panelists mentioned, a lot of our different areas intersect. And instead of working harder, why not work smarter and see where there's areas where we can work together. One of the things that we do in our district is we intentionally make sure that with the CTE department and the counseling service department, that there's some additional data points and connections. So when the CTE committee, when they have their first meeting with their CTE teachers, counseling services is invited so that they know exactly what services counseling services provides, and vice versa. When counseling services has elementary, middle, and high school counseling meeting, CTE is also there to do additional training and presentations. That way that not only on the campus level are people working together, but they see from the district level that is very important that connection is there. Also, when picking courses, now the CTE has a lot of courses at the middle school level and even the high school level, making sure everyone understands them. So the CTE teacher really knows their course curriculum, but it's important for them to make sure that they're working with the counselor so that the counselor understands it, can help with advising and making sure that they're sequencing the classes in the proper ways. Also, when we're working on four-year plans, we work together as a team to make sure not only do we have the pathway requirements together, but we also have the graduation requirements together. Because in order to move forward with the pathway, you got to make sure you graduate. So just working together as a collaborative effort, in addition, working with our college partners to make sure once you pick a career, how to expose those students to the careers, and also to help them through whatever educational avenue they need for post-secondary.
That takes a lot of effort and a lot of work, but it definitely is worth it when we think about what it does for our students. So thank you. Caroline, you have a question in the chat from Carmen, who was really interested in the idea you shared about hiring and firing for students for jobs at school. Could you tell everyone just a little bit more about that?
Sure. Yeah. So we try not to fire anyone. We give them lots of chances at this age, but we advertise through the program for fifth graders, and then sort of second semester of fourth grade, we start to allow students to interview and apply for jobs. As I mentioned, I kind of sit with the other specialists in the school and even classroom teachers, like what actually needs to be done at school. We need the car doors opened in the morning. We need the books checked in when kids come. We need students to learn sight words in kindergarten, and it doesn't take a certified teacher to, do flashcards. So we look for things in the school, and then we sort of develop these, this application process. It's an online application, and they have to have a reference from a teacher. No students precluded. So, you know, that took a mind shift for some of our staff, like, well, that student doesn't turn in their homework, they shouldn't get to participate. And, I mean, not all our staff, most of our staff was really on board, but you know how we can get stuck sometimes, like that's a privilege. But what we're really trying to say is, no, this is like, this is tier one important instruction for students to have this experiential learning opportunity. So we post and sort of advertise the different jobs. We have a morning news show. You can be anchor or behind the scenes, that type of thing. And students apply. It takes a lot of sorting. And then we invite them and their parents kind of commit to the job or help them commit to the job, do a little training. And the feedback, you know, it's pretty basic. Did they show up on time? Were they pleasant? Did they fulfill their job responsibilities? And from that feedback, we sort of try to coach them just to help them understand that's how it works. And we get a lot of great feedback from kids like, wow, if I'm not punctual, someone gets to take my place on the morning news show. Or just those kind of real life lessons. Like, I don't have the patience to work with 5-year-olds, I don't think, right? Or a lot of kids will say, you know, if being a professional soccer player doesn't work out, I'm a pretty good public speaker. I think maybe a news anchor might be a good job. So they just start to develop this idea of what they might be capable of doing.
I love that. So kind of in that same vein, Caroline, as they're getting hired for jobs, but also as you're trying to teach these students about the various career options out there, how do you start to introduce them to things that maybe they've never heard of before? You know, just expand their breadth and depth and maybe what's in their family or what they get to watch on TV so they have the best options.
Yeah, I think a big part of that is being data-driven, really surveying the kids, like, what are the types of jobs you're interested in? And they'll come up, you guys can guess, you know, I'd like to be a police officer, firefighter, teacher, nurse, or doctor, usually is like straight across the board in kindergarten and first, unless they've had exposure from a parent or family member otherwise. And then as we go, we try to shift, or professional athlete, and we'll try to shift to, it's not what do you want to do, but what can be done. And so really shifting that learning, you know, they'll get really stuck, like, I want to learn more about being a professional baseball player. I'm like, you seem to know a ton. Let's shift, like, what are some, let's just fill our brain with all the possible things that could be done by someone. So that is helpful. I think being really intentional, for example, in our career day, you know, it would probably be easy to send out an all call to parents, like, come talk about your job. And it's not that we don't do that, but I really try to say, okay, what needs to be represented? Really think about gender stereotypes and try to invite people who could maybe bust the gender stereotype a little bit. I think in all the work we do as educators, representation matters. So the presenters, we need to have presenters of color. We need to have genders represented. Our kids need to really see themselves in those roles. One year, a story I like to tell is we did a career day and the students get to self-select what careers they hear on career day. And so one was professional athlete, and it really just garnered a lot of interest from the fourth and fifth grade boys. They signed up for that. And when they arrived, it was a gold medalist who lives nearby on the women's soccer team. And they were kind of like, you're a professional athlete? And you could just see it, like, you know, busted. So I do try to make sure that various careers are represented. And also just, interesting things in addition to kind of the community helpers that they learned at the beginning stage. And I'm not afraid just to make a phone call to a random person in the community too.
That's awesome. Cold calls work well, right? From the chat, just to follow up quickly, how long do students stay in those roles that they're getting hired for at the school? Is it a year, a semester?
We do a semester, and then at the end of the semester, if they feel like it's a really good fit, they can continue, with the exception of the ever popular news show. And then they can apply for a different job second semester. And we place every student who wants a job.
And that was another question. I think they're saying, like, what if they bomb the interview? What do you do then? Do you give them tips on how to better interview or just find a better spot for them if they're interested in something?
Well, in full transparency, the interview is kind of like, hi, you know, what makes you, what are you, why are you interested in this job? You know, just kind of a, it's sort of a check. We don't do the, although that would be really great. Maybe that would be a future goal. But they have to tell why they're interested in each role they are interested in. So yeah, we could offer some feedback around that too.
Excellent. So Brian, as we're thinking about your work with elementary, middle, high, even career centers and post-secondary, if you put your developmental hat on and we think about students are in different phases of development, how are you scope and sequencing your curriculum, your program activities, classes? What does that look like throughout the span?
So because of the way that we're set up regionally, each of the school districts that we work with, you know, they really have, they control that themselves. So that's where our partnership really pays off. And so we started all the way back to identifying where our workforce needs are in our region. And even though everybody generally thinks like they know what it is in the region, we wanted to go through that exercise. And not only did we do that, we also broke it down by community and where people work in the communities that they live in. And then, and so we use that information to start to inform school districts and then have the conversation about, you know, where are the opportunities and what's familiar to students. Just like you've heard from others that, you know, there are some very popular titles, fireman, teacher, doctor, things like that, that are very common and that makes sense. But then do they really know all the other really cool things within those industries and how do we introduce those to them? So we use that as the starting point. And then depending on the school district where they are, we really take on the role of being a coach through this process because, you know, you're not going to get anywhere by arm twisting. Districts have their own set of goals and they know what they need to do. But as the conversation around career starts to become more prevalent and parents are asking questions, then they start saying to us, gee, how can we get more of that into our middle school? And so then we continue to coach them. We say, well, here's what the information says. Here's some great opportunities. And here's what we've learned from other folks. And so they also know their students, but we always make sure that we bring in some of their own local talent, if you will. So just like when, you know, when we were all younger, when you're in middle school, you look up to the high school students doing the same things that you liked. And so we bring in our stars that are our high school students that help those middle school students. And that's that aha moment. And they see a high school student that maybe they know their name or it's a neighbor or even a friend's older sibling. And it starts to make that connection and they really get excited about it. And then the other part of it that's really, really important is that there is a lot of time devoted to working with the school district's actual classroom teacher. So they may be used to teaching math the way that they've been working through their own curriculum and it's evolved, you know, but then having that permission from their central office folks to say it's okay to integrate this because it makes sense in the curriculum. So we spend time working with the teacher just so they're comfortable about it because we also don't want when we leave at the end of the week or two or whatever the sequence is that they just say, okay, we're back to what we used to. We want them to use this as a way to continue to connect it, to make it relevant. So when they're having conversation about other academics, they also say, remember that exercise we had? Here's that connection back to this particular industry. Or they make it relevant to a family member or something along those lines. So that interaction is really important. And so we spend just as much time on the adult side of this as we do on the student side.
That's great. And I'm just thinking about the young people in my life. They would always rather hear from a high school student than from any of us grown-ups. So that's really cool you bring that in. Dana, we're getting some questions in the chat about in the same vein, other districts and schools are talking to business and industry to guide the courses they offer and their programs. So how are you and your district partnering with business and industry and bringing them to the table for this work?
So our CTE department department does a very excellent job of working with businesses, not only in our immediate community, but the surrounding areas to see what type of opportunities they have to offer. We look at the Texas Workforce Commission to kind of look at the projected careers in demand, because if we set up pathways, which takes, you know, 4 years, 6 years, if you start in middle school, we want to make sure when those students graduate from those pathways that there's a on-demand job that's there. So that's very important to really work with your local workforce commission to look to see what jobs are going to be there, what jobs are high in demand, what skills are employers looking for. So we offer the high school level paid and unpaid internships and job shadowing opportunities. And our CTE department does an excellent job of setting all that up. And the counselors work together to make sure with the scheduling pieces that our students have enough time to do the internships and their core coursework. For middle school, our counselors really work directly with the businesses and industries in our area to do, it's career fairs, but it's really more of a, how did you get to the career? And how do you keep the career? In middle school is such a trying time of transition. And many times how a business partner, when they come and do a career fair, more importantly than the career is how they got there. What kind of adversities did you have to go through? How did you overcome? And so many times our middle school students really, they want to know about the career, but they really lean into the story, because if you can overcome adversity, if you can show perseverance and grit, you can be successful in almost any career that you put your mind to. So in our middle school levels, that's our focus, exposing to career, but exposing to what it takes to get there and how to keep the career. In middle school, we do a good job of trying to relate, you know, coming to work to come into school, respecting the teachers to respecting your employer, and how HR can be like your admin when you're not, you know, doing things. So kind of making those connections that the whole purpose of school is to get you ready for the workforce and how those things aren't in isolation. And for our elementary schools, we really partner with our parents to do a lot of the career fairs, our parents that are in the district and then that are in the surrounding areas. So not only are these students, they've seen the parents, they see them at pickup and drop off, but they also see how as a parent, you can be successful and be in a lot of different careers. And kind of like Carolyn said, it's very important for us to make sure that all nationalities, everyone is represented when we're talking about careers for our students, because we want them to see themselves in all careers. And so that's how we work with businesses, partners, not only just for the internships, not only just for the experience at the high school level, but at the elementary and middle school, talking about how to get there. And no matter what situation you've come through or to, or what family you're in and what kind of family traumas and experiences you've gone through, you can be successful. And so that's really important to us at the early grades. And that's how we work directly with our business partners.
You're just reminding me of how we can't really, as counselors and educators, work in the like career bucket and then the SEL bucket, that these social emotional learning skills, and Reno, you put it in the chat, of self-awareness and good decision-making and grit and perseverance. Those are really critical as we do this career work and connect to business and industry as well. So I love that. Caroline, we have a question in the chat that kind of feeds into something I wanted to talk more with you about, in that as you're planning your curriculum and your program and your activities, are you using any career interest inventories at the early grades? What standards do you use? What is sort of the foundational supports in that light that you're using as you build your programs?
Sure. Just as you just said, and was just mentioned in the chat, the CASEL, which is the Collaborative for Academic, Social, and Emotional Learning, offers us five kind of competencies for social emotional learning. And so that drives a lot of the work that we do. And that's self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, relationship skills, and responsible decision-making. So clearly, And even as adults, obviously, we're still developing those, but those are essential skills to be successful in the workplace. So that's the CASTLE standards, or the CASTLE competencies, really drive a lot of the work that we do. Additionally, I use the American School Counselor Association standards as well. So we have mindsets and behaviors for counselors to promote within schools, and then students, there are behaviors for students to acquire. So looking at those kind of standards and behaviors sort of over a crosswalk of K-5, I want to make sure that students are given the opportunity to learn those as well at various times in their elementary career.
Great. From the chat, Brian, I think this is going to you, but Dana, you may want to weigh in too. How are you all handling teacher externships that lead to work-based learning opportunities?
You mean when the school teacher gets an externship, or are you talking about students?
I think so. This is from Kara. No, Kara's asking, how do you handle teacher externships that lead to work-based learning opportunities? Kara, do you want to unmute? Were you talking about teachers?
Yeah, like for us, we've kind of seen that from an institutional level, we have really good framework, but the teachers have a hard time connecting relevance until they've been out to see where they might work with how to tie back into job skills or to give relevance to what they're teaching. And so we've tried to make it part of like our professional development days, and where we provide like a stipend and basically get a school bus and provide a tour, but it's not like a full on externship. It's more of like an exposure field trip. And I'd like to find out, you know, if there's better ways that we could show teachers what's happening actually in industry beyond like guest speakers and things to come to their classroom, where they could actually see shop floors and yards and offices and that, so they would know what the work environment looks like and explain those types of careers to students as they have questions.
So thank you, Kara, for clarifying. So we have done some of the same things that put teachers on a bus and use a professional development day to do those visits. But what we're starting to do, and we hope to do more of very soon, is bring teachers into our buildings. So it starts to make those connections from the middle school classroom to what's the training environment look like. And the other thing that's happening in our region is that the employers have really done a really good job of organizing themselves and having career fairs where they actually come to schools. And so they're making those individual connections with classroom teachers so they could start to talk. And then each of our districts also, by virtue of these conversations that are happening, they're also doing their own individual outreach. So we've said to businesses, you keep coming to us because we can develop talent. So when students graduate from high school, if they want to go right to the workforce, they can, but they live in the neighborhoods of the high school that's, you know, right in your backyard. And here's the contact person there. So we facilitate those conversations to help make that happen as well.
Right.
And I would also add, In our district, we have a lot of on-site things. So with culinary, we have full culinary kitchens. With auto, we have the actual, you know, a full shop. With dentistry, with nursing, we have the actual things that you would see if you were to go into the actual internship. We have that on our facilities. So not only are the teachers, they don't have to go anywhere. They can go in the building or they can come visit that particular campus to see it. And so we bring a lot of things to the campus, and our business partners have done a good job of donating and helping us kind of model what it would look like in those different workplaces. So just have a day on day interaction with those particular facilities at their school. And so do the teachers as well.
Great, thank you, Dana. Dana, I'm going to pop back to you. In this time of the global pandemic, we've really had to lean into technology more than ever. And I know that you're a partner with Zello, our sponsor for today, but could you tell us a little more about the student career series you're using? And then any, if there's any other technology programs you want to highlight, that would be great as well.
Perfect. Well, yes, Zello has been just a great partner with our district. And the reason why we sought them out is because our motto is from cradle to career. And we went back and forth saying, well, should we say cradle to college or cradle to career? But if you really think about it, the goal is to have a career. The different aspects of education vary depending on what career you decide to go into. And so with Zello, it has a very robust college platform, but even more so career. And it helps us work with our students from kindergarten all the way to 12th grade. And so some of the things we do is we use it for our K through second students. They have a career town where they can explore different careers, play different games. And it gives them an idea to kind of bring careers to life that a career fair can't, where they get hands-on experience through technology because this generation, they know how to deal with games and technology. So it allows them to practice being a nurse and giving medication or working as a groomer and helping pets and things like that. From the 3 through 5 angle, it is they have different missions where or lessons where the students actually research different careers. They're actually doing different soft skill activities. And we've been using that before the pandemic, but even now as opportunities for them to work on their soft skills and also for career exploration. In our district, what we do is a peer-to-peer career fair. So all of our fifth graders, they research using Zello a career, and we ask them to research a career not based on what career they would want, but based on what subject they like in school. So if it's math, science, social studies. And so Zello gives us an opportunity to have kids search for careers by subject, by alpha, by career cluster, different things like that. So when you say your favorite subject is math, it gives you just hundreds and hundreds of careers that go through, have a math background. And so we ask students to pick things that they wouldn't normally pick, like a doctor or a lawyer, and those things are good, but just step out of their comfort zone and pick different things. And so those fifth graders, they do a presentation using Zello for the research pieces. And Zello not only tells them about the career, it tells them about the demand in the future. It tells them how much money you'll be making projected in the future. So they do those research projects and they share it with the first and third graders in the school. So it's kind of like a career fair, but led by the fifth grade students. And we've noticed that our younger kids really dial in and tune in more closely than when we have an actual career fair with adults, because they're interested. They see their fifth grade peers throughout the campuses, but they're interested. And they know that when they, it becomes kind of like a rites of passage. Like, I can't wait till I get into fifth grade because I can do the peer-to-peer career fair and present in front of everyone else. So that's been a really good help. With Zello for the middle schools and high school, it really helps us with course planning. They have the best I've seen so far. Course planning for counselors is a must because we've got to make sure for CTE people, we got to make sure your sequences is right. And so it helps us with making sure that we have the proper sequences for your pathways, that we have the proper requirements for your pathways. And all of this is embedded into Zello. From in Texas, we graduate by endorsements. And so you have to have certain classes in order to graduate in addition to core classes. So it helps the counselors keep up with it. And it also shows the students what we're doing and helps them keep up with it as well. So I know that's not the jazzy part of CTE, but the big part is we got to make sure that you have your coherent sequences so you have your funding and things like that. And so it really helps in that area with research as well. So we have been very pleased with the product. I think we have pre-K centers, and even though our students aren't assigned a Zello account at pre-K because it starts at kindergarten, our counselors do guidance lessons with them, talking to them as early as pre-K about the different careers. But like I said, in our district, we want to make sure not just the careers, but that you can be successful. You don't have to have a prerequisite in order to be successful in life. You don't have to come from a certain zip code. You don't have to look a certain way. All these careers are yours for the taking, and we're going to provide you CTE opportunities in order to get where you want to go. So Zello really helps us with making that a reality for our students.
I so wish I had had Zello when I was a high school counselor auditing transcripts. How helpful that would have been. And I really love how your district's saying cradle to career. I think sometimes in this age of everybody goes to college or post-secondary, we forget that that's just one step on the pathway to a lifelong career. So I really like hearing how you all are embracing that. In the chat, someone's asked if any of us are using the priest, if I'm saying that right. Are any of you on the panel using that technology program for virtual industry and business tours? And if not, Michelle, would you want to unmute and just quickly tell us a little bit about it?
Going to the high school.
I apologize. Will you ask that again?
Yeah, you had just typed in the chat asking about NAPRIS and that it's a free tool for business and industry. I think it, I lost the tours. Is your district using it and are you liking it? It perked my interest when I heard free.
Yes, we love free. And so we use it both brick and mortar and we use it for our virtual school that we have. We have the very first career tech focused virtual school in the state of Alabama that's a program of us. And so they're the ones that actually introduced us to it. And it's phenomenal. It's a phenomenal resource. It's free. You are able to search different business industry sectors. It allows you to virtually tour those business industries. It also includes interviews with some of the different business leaders and with people that hold jobs in that career field. There's videos that it will push out. Our students have really enjoyed it, and especially now that we're having to do a lot remote, it has really enabled us to still stay in touch with that business and industry. And it's all over the US. So right. It may show you a plant in Michigan. It may show you somewhere in California. It may show you somewhere. That would be the only downfall. What we've done is we've started to do these for our own business industry here in Alabama and submit those to be included in their platform. And so they allow that as well.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for sharing. And I just saw Major Clarity as a program. Erin popped up. I have a lot of colleagues that use that as well. An excellent online resource to check out. Thanks everyone for contributing. Brian, I want to circle back to you in that, you know, we're all right now, especially right now, but I don't know, I feel like we've had this conversation a long time about how do we have equitable and inclusive access for all of our students and families, especially as it relates to CTE, but even in general, and education and rigorous curriculum and resources and tools at school. How are you doing that? What advice do you have for us on that?
Well, so this is my fourth year here. And one of the things that's unique about career centers is that generally it's 2 years when you're actually in the building in Ohio. And there are some variations. So for us, and we serve 10 different communities, and we really didn't realize how much work we needed to do, because it was often, you know, teachers focus on a few students working through those programs. And as we started to embrace the idea of the responsibility of the career center to do work to the other, to the lower grades, we also started to realize that just as how much work we had to do and how important it was to give really high quality information to our families and to the school districts that we serve. and not just sitting back and saying, we'll take them as they come, but no, let's take some ownership and take a leadership position and start to help with information. And so we started changing some of our practices. We actually hired a consultant to help us work through this. And, you know, we're working on putting advisory committees together, you know, for a task force for myself. We put all kinds of professional development for our teachers and start to identify where our own gaps were. And then also what I think has been really powerful is the actual students I call professional development for the students, but for them just to understand, you know, for many of the times, you know, 10 school districts, kids are very different. And just getting to learn and understand each other when they, you know, they live, you know, 40 miles apart, 50 miles apart, it might be the first time that they've ever sat next to somebody who speaks a different language. And so how do we start to understand that? And you can't do it as an instructor, you can't help the students unless you as an instructor understand. And then you have to understand the families and the community. So it's really an ecosystem that we needed to do a better job at. So the leadership team, we've rolled our sleeves up, we have some plans in place. And you know, we don't have the magic formula yet, but I will say that you can't ignore it. You have to embrace it and reach out and communicate and ask questions. And probably early on when we actually hired somebody to help us because we knew that there were things we didn't know. And so being willing to do that and go there is a big step as an organization. I would recommend to school districts that, you know, if you think you probably need to improve, you probably do. And so reach out to somebody that's an expert and help them and have them guide you through the process.
That's really great advice. And I would even go as far to say that we can all use improvement and we always will. And this is just work that we continue to try to get better at every day, every year on behalf of our students and families. Dana, we have a question in the chat that I'm going to toss to you. Do you believe that middle grades are capable of moving beyond exploration and into some foundational skill and career development?
I do. And especially with the changes in being able to push some of those principal classes into the middle school, that has helped as well. Moving just beyond like the career exploration classes, and they're actually able to take those principles in business or principles in ag type classes. So I do think that they are. And I think that students will rise to whatever expectations that we give them. And the fact that many districts are starting so early with career exploration in elementary school, I think that they're ready in middle school to move to the next level. In the past, we didn't start talking about careers until middle school. Now, like I said, in my district, we're starting in pre-K. So when that pre-K student gets to sixth, seventh grade, they're ready to take some principal's classes. They're ready to start their pathway. You know, we've gone through the exploration. So I definitely think since the trajectory is starting so early in elementary school, that middle school can do it. And with the way funding is, being able to push some of the ACT courses that traditionally we only had at the high school level for freshmen, we're able to push it down, you know, as low as seventh grade. I think that they are capable as long as you're in a district that believes that they are capable.
Yeah. So that leads me to another question in the chat that you may know, Dana. Can Perkins funding be used below seventh grade at the elementary level for introductory CTE career development?
To my knowledge, I don't think it can be. I'm not sure on that one as far as the courses. I can speak to the courses. I haven't seen many courses, like principals courses, put down that low. But someone that actually is in the CTE field would be able to speak more to that. But I know that there's a lot of creative ways to use the Perkins funding. Yeah. I know that with our district, in order to have just a level playing field across, you know, with elementary counselors, you have, you know, these are some of the points that we're going to do, but sometimes you have variations between the campuses. What our CTE department does is they give, you know, small stipends to elementary counselors that have different, if they did a peer-to-peer career, if they've done a poster contest, So just making sure that career development is across the board in elementary. So I know you can be creative. I'm not the expert on that. I can speak towards the courses that counselors have planned, and I've seen it to seventh grade.
Yeah, and we're getting some answers in the chat too. And I think ultimately the usage is decided at the state level. Thanks everybody for weighing in to help us answer that. As we kind of start to wrap up, Caroline, there's lots of chat. They want all your resources on student interviewing and hiring and applications. So I hope you're willing to share that. We can get it to Brandy and get it out to everyone. And yes, this recording will be available. The slides will be available. We'll get you copies of all of that for those who participated today. And then if you have colleagues that couldn't be here but wanted to be, that are members of ACTE, I believe this is in our rich library of offerings to go back to. Is that correct, Steve?
Yes, the library after the recording is available to any ACT member.
Great. Well, we have about 3 minutes left to our panel. Are there any last words of wisdom you want to share with the group today before we wrap up? Go ahead, Caroline.
No, I was just going to say thanks for the opportunity to talk. And just, I encourage you, I think us elementary counselors are always eager to support CTE, and sometimes we don't exactly know how, so any partnership reaching to the elementary level. And I know just keeping that focus that it's tier one instruction, it's just part of what all kids get, I think kind of helps kids be prepared in middle and high school. So
thank you. Yes,
and I definitely want to say thank you for all the CTE teachers and all the CTE directors on the call. I mean, I think that with CTE and the programs that they provide, the pathways, you're just expanding the opportunities for students that I know, even growing up, I didn't have these opportunities that kids have today. I know in our district, we have a wonderful CTE executive director, director, and just teachers that go above and beyond every day to expose our students. And I know many of you on the call do the same. So thank you for all the hard work you do. Pandemic, without pandemic, I know you work extra hours and make sure your kids get what they need. So thank you for all that you're doing for our students.
Yes, I'll just echo what Dana said. I know that educators have the hardest and busiest job long before this global pandemic, but even more so now. So we really appreciate and acknowledge all you do on behalf of students and families, especially related to CTE. We thank you for taking the time out of your busy, busy day to join us for this webinar. And I hope that you will keep your eyes peeled for the next email on the second part in this series sponsored by Zello. So thank you, everyone. Have a great rest of your afternoon.